Hello, good afternoon. Today's lecture will be on Letter from Birmingham Jail by Martin Luther King. In this lecture, I will look at two aspects of the text, both the rhetorical situation, the situation in which the text was produced, and the human rights arguments that King makes in Letter from Birmingham Jail. Letter from Birmingham Jail was written in April 1963. At the time, King had been leading protest demonstrations against racial segregation in Birmingham, Alabama. During one of the protests, he was arrested for parading without a permit. On the day of King's arrest, the Birmingham News published an open letter titled A Call for Unity. This was a statement by eight white clergymen who expressed general sympathy for King and the demonstrators' goals, but ultimately criticized King's activities and methods as unwise and untimely. They urged African Americans not to participate in the protest demonstrations and called for more moderate and reasonable approaches to racial problems. In this context, King's letter is both an explanation for his actions and a response to a call for unity. I will now offer some broad historical context for the year 1963. I hope to both provide some insight into how Letter from Birmingham Jail fits into the civil rights movement, and also give a sense of what life was like in popular culture in 1963. On January 14th, George Wallace became governor of Alabama. In his inaugural speech, he defiantly proclaimed, "Segregation now, segregation tomorrow, and segregation forever." Later that month, African-American student Harvey Gantt entered Clemson University in South Carolina, the last state to hold out against racial integration. In April, King would be arrested in Birmingham and would write Letter from Birmingham Jail. Then, on June 12th, Medgar Evers, the civil rights activist, would be assassinated in Jackson, Mississippi. At the end of the summer, James Meredith would become the first black person to graduate from the University of Mississippi. And on August 28th, King would deliver his I Have a Dream speech on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial. On September 15th, the 16th Street Baptist Church bombing in Birmingham would kill 4 children and injure 22. And finally, on November 22nd, John F. Kennedy would be assassinated in Dallas, Texas. I will now transition to a list of some notable events in popular culture. In March, Iron Man would first appear in a Marvel comic. On May 8th, Dr. No, the first James Bond film, would be shown in the United States. And on May 27th, Bob Dylan would release his second album, The Freewheeling Bob Dylan, on Columbia Records. In that fall, the Los Angeles Dodgers would defeat the Yankees 4-0 in the World Series. And 2 days later, Sam Cooke and his band would be arrested after trying to register at a whites-only motel in Louisiana. Then, on December 26th, at the end of the year, the Beatles songs I Want to Hold Your Hand and I Saw Her Standing There are released in the United States, marking the beginning of Beatlemania. And I want to briefly look at two songs from 1963. The first, A Change Is Gonna Come, was recorded by Sam Cooke after Cooke and his band were arrested. The second song is Blowing in the Wind by Bob Dylan. This song was featured in Freewheeling Bob Dylan. Both songs represent the spirit of 1963, representing the massive changes that were occurring.
In a little tent, oh, and just like the river I've been running ever since. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. It's been too to die.
Returning to the letter from Birmingham Jail, I want to focus a bit on the audience. King's letter ultimately had two audiences, the ostensible audience, the clergymen who had written the call to unity, but also the larger audience in the United States that he was hoping to appeal to. The letter from Birmingham Jail was circulated in various forms in May 1963 and was published in full in three magazines in June. The Christian Century, The New Leader, and The Atlantic Monthly. A slightly revised version was then published a year later in King's 1964 book, Why We Can't Wait. How do we know who the audience is? There are two ways to identify an audience. One is through textual evidence, what is in the actual text, and then the contextual evidence, the evidence not in the text, but surrounding the publication, distribution, and circulation of the text. If we look at the three magazines that the text was originally published in, we can get a sense of who King was appealing to. Here are the general audiences for each of the three magazines that originally published Letter from Birmingham Jail. Christian Century, college-educated liberal Christians, New Leader, college-educated left-of-center moderate liberals, and The Atlantic Monthly, college-educated centrist moderate liberals. We can also think about who the audience is by looking at context. Information on Birmingham protests and national debates on racial inequality will give us a sense of what type of audiences were interested in this issue and were interested in reading something by Martin Luther King. We can also get a sense of who the audience is by looking at other texts in the conversation. By looking at A Call for Unity, we can get a strong idea of who was likely to engage the argument. Another way to identify an audience is to analyze textual evidence. King targets specific values in Letter from Birmingham Jail. He appeals to Judeo-Christian ethical traditions, and he appeals to liberal ideals. He also references a variety of figures, including Christian martyrs like St. Thomas and secular heroes like Thomas Jefferson and Socrates. In addition, King quotes from famous documents, which provide significant insight into who King was appealing to. He references both the Bible and the Declaration of Independence. Ultimately, the intended audience of King's letter is not only people who care about the basic issues he addresses, but also those who embrace the Judeo-Christian and liberal ideals that his arguments assume. I will now analyze some of the human rights arguments that King makes in Letter from Birmingham Jail. One of the first moves that King makes is identifying the organization that invited him and his staff to come to Birmingham as a human rights organization. The Alabama Christian Movement for Human Rights was the local organization that initially brought King to Birmingham. King writes, "Several months ago, our local affiliate here in Birmingham invited us to be on call to engage in a nonviolent direct action program, if such were deemed necessary. We readily consented, and when the hour came, We lived up to our promises. So I am here along with several members of my staff because we were invited here. I'm here because I have basic organizational ties here. So here we see him affiliate himself with human rights and human rights organizations. To better understand the values of the Alabama Christian Movement for Human Rights, we can look at the language of their Declaration of Principles. In this document, the ACMHR asserts its commitment to human rights while also echoing the language of documents like the Declaration of Independence and the UDHR. For example, as free and independent citizens of the United States of America and of the state of Alabama, we express publicly our determination to press forward persistently for freedom and democracy and the removal from our society any forms of second-class citizenship. We believe in states' rights, but we believe that any first rights are human rights. And the first right of a state is to protect human rights and to guarantee to each of its citizens the same rights and privileges. We shall never become enemies of the white people. We are all Americans, but America was born in the struggle for freedom from tyranny and oppression, and we seek guidance from our Heavenly Father and from all men goodwill and understanding. So here we definitely see the language of the UDHR, especially the preamble, which represents this ideal of a human family and interconnectedness. We also see some of the language from the Declaration of Independence, freedom from tyranny and oppression, freedom and democracy, goodwill and understanding. We also see this belief that individual rights come before state interests. Overall, this organization is representative of how many organizations in the civil rights movement used human rights to fight for justice. Another example of human rights rhetoric is King's famous line, "Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere." In this passage, we see multiple human rights values, the interrelatedness of everyone, a cohesive human family, the idea that human rights apply to everyone and everywhere, and the premise that if you do believe in human rights, you will fight injustice anywhere. King writes, "I am cognizant of the interrelatedness of all communities and states. I cannot sit idly by in Atlanta and not be concerned about what happens in Birmingham. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. We are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. Anyone who lives inside the United States can never be considered an outsider." And you can see how a human rights argument appeals to someone, say, in Maine or Pennsylvania or Idaho to care about injustice in the South. We may be separated by thousands of miles, but a human rights paradigm demands that we attend to injustice in any corner of the country. A final human rights argument that King makes in the letter from Birmingham Jail is one that addresses violations of political and legal rights. In particular, he elaborates on how African Americans in the South have been unable to participate in democracy and have therefore been unable to participate in the creation of laws that they are held accountable to. King writes, "There are two types of laws. There are just laws and there are unjust laws. An unjust law is a code inflicted upon a minority, which that minority had no part in enacting or creating because it did not have the unhampered right to vote. Who can say that the legislature of Alabama set up the segregation laws was democratically elected? Throughout the state of Alabama, all types of conniving methods are used to prevent African Americans from becoming registered voters, and there are some counties without a single African American registered to vote." In this passage, King argues for the right to participate in one's own government and the right to participate in creating the laws, as well as the right not to be denied political agency because of arbitrary or discriminatory laws. We can align Letter from Birmingham Jail with other human rights arguments in the way that King targets indifference as an obstacle for justice. King is very critical of the indifference he has seen from white moderates. An indifference to racism, white supremacy, and inequality. King's use of language also reflects the human rights rhetoric of Eli Weissel. In texts such as his memoir Night and his speech The Perils of Indifference from 1999, where he explains how indifference leads to injustice. Some of the most horrifying scenes in Night aren't of violence inflicted on Jewish prisoners, but rather the indifference expressed by German soldiers and regular citizens. In this passage, King elaborates on the dangers of indifference. I must confess that over the last few years, I have been gravely disappointed with the white moderate. I have almost reached the regrettable conclusion that the great stumbling block in the stride toward freedom is not the white citizens counselor or the Ku Klux Klanner, but the white moderate who is more devoted to order than to justice, who prefers a negative peace, which is the absence of tension, to a positive peace, which is the presence of justice. Shallow understanding from people of goodwill is more frustrating than absolute misunderstanding from people of ill will. King elaborates on the dangers of indifference by targeting the indifference of time. King identifies this fundamental flaw in asking patience from activists in the civil rights movement. Time is neutral, it is indifferent, and therefore people who are asking for more time are actually fostering indifference. King writes, I had also hoped that the white moderate would reject the myth of time. It is the strangely irrational notion that there is something in the very flow of time that will inevitably cure all ills. Actually, time is neutral. It can be used either destructively or constructively. We must come to see that human progress never rolls in on the wheels of inevitability. It comes through the tireless efforts and persistent work of men willing to be co-workers with God. And without this hard work, time itself becomes an ally of the forces of social stagnation. If one does not fight for justice, then one is enabling injustice. This logic is very similar to Weissel's appreciation or measurement of indifference. If one does not fight for justice, one is inevitably enabling injustice. King also addresses the indifference he has seen in the church. Many religious leaders have fallen for the myth of time. And whether or not they are conscious of it, they are enabling injustice. Their inaction has let down the civil rights movement, and this inaction has exposed a dangerous indifference within certain religious organizations. Let me rush on to mention my other disappointment. I have been disappointed with the white church and its leadership. I felt that white ministers, priests, and rabbis of the South would be some of our strongest allies. Instead, some few have been outright opponents, refusing to understand the freedom movement and misrepresenting its leaders. All too many others have been more cautious than courageous and have remained silent behind the security of stained glass windows. A final way that King expresses human rights values is the way that he practices nonviolent direct action. Nonviolent direct action offers a paradigm for negotiating differences within communities. In Letter from Birmingham Jail, King identifies the four components for nonviolent direct action. He writes, in any nonviolent campaign, there are four basic steps. One, collection of the facts to determine whether injustices are alive. Two, negotiation. Three, self-purification. And four, direct action. You may well ask, why direct action? Why sit-ins, marches, and so forth? Isn't negotiation a better path? You are exactly right in your call for negotiation. Indeed, this is the purpose of direct action. Nonviolent direct action seeks to create such a crisis and establish such creative tension that a community that has consistently refused to negotiate is forced to confront the issue. Ultimately, King is committed to using nonviolent strategies to produce dialogue and conversation. This was the same motivating factor for the drafters of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, to create a nonviolent framework for securing peace and for working through inherent tensions in society. King elaborates on this dynamic of nonviolent direct action. "This may sound rather shocking," he writes, "but I must confess that I am not afraid of the word tension. I've earnestly worked and preached against violent tension. There is a type of constructive, nonviolent tension that is necessary for growth. Just as Socrates felt that it was necessary to create tension in the mind so that individuals could rise from the bondage of myths and half-truths, we must see the need of having nonviolent gadflies to create the kind of tension in society that will help men to rise from the dark depths of prejudice and racism to the majestic heights of understanding and brotherhood. Too long has our beloved Southland been bogged down in that tragic attempt to live in monologue rather than dialogue. This faith in dialogue, this belief that people with different cultural backgrounds, different ethnicities, different nationalities can produce a dialogue, can have a conversation, a productive conversation, reflects the fundamental hopes and values of human rights discourse. King believes in the power of language, the power of rhetoric, the power of narrative, and the power of symbols. King found inspiration in human rights rhetoric and in human rights values. In some moments, he explicitly cites rights and uses rights language to advance an argument. In other examples, his human rights rhetoric is more implicit. Overall, King's worldview aligned with and even drew from human rights discourse, and he ultimately believed there were nonviolent ways to achieve peace. Moreover, he saw the power of rhetoric for building coalitions, coalitions within countries, but also coalitions, building international coalitions. He had a fundamental faith in what the drafters of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights referred to as the human family, and a belief that dialogue could secure peace, and that through dialogue, this human family could, in the words of King, reach the majestic heights of understanding and brotherhood. I will now conclude today's lecture. I hope you found it informative, not only as an example of rhetorical analysis, but as a demonstration of the power of human rights rhetoric.